guys, take it easy.
Hit him! Hit him! You want to make big money? You want to do something? Hit him, baby! Hit him!
And welcome to Pro Wrestling This Week. I'm Joe Pedicino.
And I'm Gordon Solie, and we do have indeed an interesting hour in store for you. We're going to be going to the Calgary Stampede Wrestling. We'll also be traveling to San Juan, Puerto Rico, to Portland, Oregon, to Birmingham, Alabama, to the greater Atlanta area. We'll also be having ring reports about the great Thanksgiving matches that occurred all around the country. Our Matt Classic this week concerns one of the fiercest competitors the world has ever seen. I'm referring, of course, to the Sheik. That Matt Classic goes back to 1963. This and much, much more upcoming, Joe.
That's right. You know, Gordon, we're going to start off, as you said, in Calgary. But before we go there, a very special hello to all of our new viewers in Los Angeles, California, watching us now every Saturday morning at 9:30 on KCOP. A very special hello to all of our new California viewers. As we said, we were going to start off in Calgary, Canada. It was supposed to be a tag team match, Owen Hart and Ben Bazarab going up against the Viet Cong Express 1 and 2. But before they could get to the ring, J.R. Foley and his army attacked the team and literally put Owen Hart in the hospital. He had to be carried away. That left Ben Bazarab to go against the Viet Cong Express alone. We're going to join this match in progress now. It's a two-on-one situation. Ben Bazarab says he'll take him on by himself. He goes into the ring in Calgary Stampede.
Pile driver coming up. An amazing move to reverse that pile driver, but once again, interference by the second Viet Cong. Bazarab taking incredible punishment, and referee Jürgen Hermann is the subject of a lot of catcalls from this capacity crowd.
Well, into that turnbuckle, cut the clothesline in desperation.
Amazing heart, amazing guts by Ben Bazarab. Fighting an uphill battle, two against one.
Look at him, go to work.
That big drop kick and headbutt, that's really shaking up that Viet Cong, but not for long, there's the tag. You could hear that right over here.
Yes, sir.
Karate kick to the throat. Off those ropes. Look at this move by Bazarab.
Oh, really? Did you see that?
He jammed that martial arts stick right into the neck of Ben Bazarab.
He didn't see it.
And look at this.
Look at this. Hit them both. Where's the referee?
Bazarab going to town with that martial arts stick.
Well, it's cleaning house time. Cleaning house, and of course, the referee, not seeing anything, will disqualify Bazarab.
That's unbelievable.
Welcome back to Pro Wrestling This Week. You know, Gordon, a lot of wrestlers would not have gone into that ring two-on-one. Ben Bazarev, though, was so upset over what happened to his partner, Owen Hart, that he said, yes, I'll take on the Viet Cong Express by myself. And I might add, he didn't do too bad of a job.
Very true, Joe. No question about it. Right now, we're going to travel south of the border to San Juan, Puerto Rico, where Joe Pedicino was recently the guest of the World Wrestling Council, was on hand in San Juan to present the Wrestler of the Month Award to a well-deserving competitor, Invader Number One. Let's see how this interview goes.
Well, Hugo, obviously the fans here love Invader One. Everyone knows the Invader Number One, one of the greatest heroes in the wrestling world. And in my travels, in my position, I travel around the world seeing the finest wrestlers in the world every day of the week. It's my pleasure to be here today to present to the Invader One from the World Wrestling Council this plaque. And I would like to, at this time, read the plaque and present it to the Invader.
Let me translate to the fans first what we were
saying. All right.
Para traducir lo que dice el vicepresidente del Consejo Mundial, para él es un orgullo venir a Puerto Rico para hacer entrega de esta placa como luchador del mes de octubre al Invader 1, el viaje alrededor del mundo, y este es un privilegio que él viene aquí para presentar esta placa y va a leer la siguiente lo que dice.
The World Wrestling Council proudly awards the Puerto Rican wrestler Invader Number One with this distinguished award of Wrestler of the Month for the month of October. In recognition for the great accomplishments of this fantastic athlete, congratulations, Invader Number One, from the Board of Directors of the WWC, Martin Levy, President of the WWC, 11-17-86. And congratulations for being the Wrestler of the Month for October.
Bueno, la entrega oficial, la placa dice más o menos, el Consejo Mundial de Lucha, la Junta de Directores del Consejo Mundial le otorgan esta placa merecida méritos al Invader 1 por ser declarado luchador del mes de octubre a nombre de todos los miembros directores del Consejo Mundial de Lucha. Está la fecha abajo y el nombre del presidente Marvin Levy. Tus palabras, Invader 1.
Thank you very much for coming to Puerto Rico, all the way to Puerto Rico from the United States to give me this. I really appreciate. Quiero darle las gracias al caballero aquí por venir a nuestra isla y darme esta placa. Me siento muy orgulloso porque en realidad esta placa no es para mí. Esta placa son para nosotros, los fanáticos, para ustedes los fanáticos, que yo siempre, donde quiera que voy, pongo el nombre de Puerto Rico en alto y seguiré haciendo todo lo posible por hacerlo siempre.
Felicitaciones. And thank you very much, Mr. Pedicino, for being here, and we hope this is not the last visit.
It won't be. I love Puerto Rico, and we will be back.
A well-deserved award, Joe.
That's true. You know, the Invader Number One, what should have been one of the greatest nights of his life, unfortunately later in the night turned into a disaster. Next week here on Pro Wrestling This Week, we'll show you just what happened to the Invader Number One. Now, while I was there, I was introduced to a newcomer. His name, Jason the Terrible. He's very impressive. Let's go to our international match of the week from San Juan, Puerto Rico, as we see Jason the Terrible take on Charlie Camper.
Queridos amigos, vamos a presentar a continuación este encuentro pactado a una caída o 10 minutos de duración. Inmediatamente en la esquina técnica, pesando 225 libras de la Florida, Charles Camper. En la esquina rudísima, con 270 libras de peso y de un lugar desconocido, Jason el Terrible. Su apoderado, Chiqui Star, árbitro Ricky Vargas Beníquez.
Padín, y rápidamente entró a la carga este señor Jason el Terrible, pero ha sido sorprendido por Charles Camper, pero se recupera Jason el Terrible. Y yo creo que se ha metido en un problema este señor Charles Camper. Enfrentarse con esta amenaza humana en ese cuadrilátero es algo bastante difícil.
Ahí está el castigo violento por parte del Terrible. Y el castigo diríamos que es verdaderamente terrible. ¡Avi María, tremendo! En plena cintura. Le abrió la cintura, aparentemente. Ahí está el rodillazo en ella misma por parte de Jason el Terrible, dominando terriblemente a su adversario técnico, también procedente de la Florida. Ahí está Jason el Terrible tomando por el pelo a Charles Camper. Viene con él, mis amigos. ¡Ah, lanza de esquina contra Camper! Vuelve Jason el Terrible a tomar la iniciativa sobre su adversario, lo impulsa. Ahí está una guindolina, mis amigos. Parece que va a hacer todo, efectivamente, mis amigos. Acaba de rendirlo. acabó de rendirlo, mis amigos. Ahí lo tienen alto y se acabó el encuentro. Victoria para Jason el Terrible.
Jason the Terrible, impressive indeed with that backbreaker. Let's move along now to the greater Atlanta area and deep south wrestling, where Tommy Wildfire Rich brought in quite a challenge to the Masked Assassin. That challenge was in the form of Grizzly Boone. Let's take a look at what happens to the assassin when he meets Grizzly Boone.
Well, the assassin claims that Dirty Rhodes has taken care of Big Bubba and that Big Bubba's not going to be here tonight.
Well, see, if I didn't know but one person, that may be a problem. But like I said, I had two or three different people that wanted to collect that money. $25, big money, but they wanted to come get you. So whether, whether Big Bubba's here, it don't matter. Because like I said, I got something for you, and I guarantee you, he gonna yank that mask right off of your head, Jack. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And Nick, it's two on one. What is Tommy Rich doing?
I don't know. I got out of the way of that one quick.
They've got
him.
He's
in big trouble. Oh, no, he's in the ring with both of them. Dirty Rhodes. Wait a minute. Grizzly Boone.
Grizzly Boone.
What's Grizzly Boone doing out here?
Grizzly Boone.
He just nailed Dirty Rhodes, and he's coming in. Well, the assassin's all over him. Whoa.
Now he's gone in. This is the surprise Bobby Rich had. Look at him pick up the assassin. Oh, no. Here comes the... He's got him. He's got
it.
Now he's going after the mask. And down on the floor, we've got Dirty Rhodes, who got hit with that knocker and is still down.
He just walked up and bumped him right on the top of the head. Dropped
he's
him
going after the mask.
Uh-oh.
He's got it. He's getting it off.
Uh-oh.
He's getting it off.
This will be it for the assassin.
This will be it. We're finally going to get
the mask. He got the mask. He got the mask.
He got the mask off.
We can see his face.
The mask. Wait a minute. Get the camera on it.
I can't see his face. Dirty Rhodes.
Get the camera on the assassin.
Dirty Rhodes has pulled that top shirt up over his head. I don't think I didn't get a good look at his face.
Tommy. If Tommy Rich had just been thinking, they could have gone over and they could have grabbed him. The cameraman's even walking out.
Oh, mercy. He got that mask.
What a surprise Tommy Rich had for the assassin.
I
want to find out how Dirty Rhodes took care of Big Bubba.
That
Did he pay him off? Did he hurt him? What happened? But look at what Tommy Rich had standing by just in case. We haven't seen Grizzly Boone in a few months here in Deep South, but when he comes back, he comes back.
Pro wrestling this week. I think the assassin's going to have his hands full with this fellow Grizzly Boone. And I'll tell you what, we've had our hands full for the past couple of weeks with Michael Hayes.
Well, you know, we've been telling you for the past couple of weeks that Michael Hayes wanted to do a special segment for pro wrestling this week. We were calling it P.S. Michael Hayes Postscript. He just determined to call it P.S. Rumors. You know, we don't like to deal so much with rumors here on pro wrestling this week. We prefer to give facts. But with Michael Hayes, sometimes facts and rumors sway over the line, shall we say. Let's go to the first initial segment of Michael Hayes, and let's call it P.S. Rumors.
Hello, ladies. Hello, everybody who watches pro wrestling this week. You know something, baby? It seems that my man, Joe Pettisito, he's been doing a real good job of covering wrestling from all over. But see, lately he's been hampered by the fact of the influxuation of mail coming to his offices and trying to read and answer all these letters of people saying, we've got to know more about the UWF. We've got to know more about the Universal Wrestling Federation. Well, who would be better than yours truly, Michael P.S. Purely Sexy, and I think it speaks for itself, Hayes, than to give you the lowdown on the biggest thing in professional wrestling, the UWF. I mean, man, I'm one-third of the Fabulous Freebirds, the greatest thing that ever hit wrestling. We're sitting on top of the UWF, the greatest wrestling organization that there is, man. And right here on the show that catches you up with everything. Like I said, Joe Pettisino, baby, I know you've been trying hard, but you know, just like Jim Ross was trying hard, he had to have PS's help. And y'all don't feel bad because there's other people. And see, I'm going to have a lot of insight for y'all. I'm going to have some special interviews. But even if I don't, me is special enough.
Well, it looks like we're going to have our hands full with Michael Hayes every week. It'll be interesting to see who his guest star on upcoming weeks of PS Rumors. Right now, it's time for a rundown of what happened in New Orleans on Thanksgiving night at the big Popeye Spectacular with the UWF. The one-man gang was able to hold on to his heavyweight title, and then, what a night, he also won the $100,000 Battle Royal, that big two-ring Battle Royal. In the double cage match that night, Dr. Death was able to defeat Michael Hayes in a steel cage, and at the same time in a barbed wire cage, Terry Taylor defeated Buddy Roberts. A great night, over 13,000 people there at the Superdome, the largest crowd for a wrestling event in 3 years at the Superdome in New Orleans. Some sad news now from the UWF. Hollywood John Tatum in a serious car accident this week in Shreveport, Louisiana. He came out with two broken legs and some internal injuries. Now, in the past few days, he has taken a turn for the better. The doctors say the legs were broken cleanly, and they should heal in 2 to 3 months, and we should be seeing Hollywood John Tatum back in action at about that time. Now, also in the UWF, the big Pro Wrestling Illustrated tournament going on, that $100,000 tournament. This week we saw a match between Sting and Dr. Death Steve Williams. Let's take a look at just how that match came about.
It proved a great deal. Taking it to Steve, Dr. Death Williams. Sting showing some offensive brilliance here on Universal Wrestling. An elbow squarely to the chest of Dr. Death, and that flying fist. Sting, if you ever notice his elevation, he really gets up in the air on that maneuver. And that one, elbow, and it caught Dr. Death. Sting going for the kill here. But he didn't grapevine the leg, and I don't care how strong he is, he's not going to hold Dr. Death down that way, nor is anyone else. Sting now up on the second rope. He's taking a long time up there. And Dr. Death raised the knee, and it met the midsection of Sting quite squarely. And Dr. Death now back on his feet, and there's a right hand that struck home. And another one, the doctor making a very physical house call here. Clothesline by the doctor, Dr. Death Steve Williams. Dr. Death, a little bit hesitant in that lateral press. Oh, my gosh. What a forearm. And Dr. Death now. And another one. Nice reversal by Sting. Sting with a clothesline to Dr. Death in the corner. That's an unusual maneuver. But Missy Hyatt's up on that, on the ring apron for no apparent reason. I wish they wouldn't even let her at ringside. Dr. Death with a stampede. Dr. Death with a modified stampede, but he got it. And Fergie is preoccupied, as are a lot of men, with Missy Hyatt. But Dr. Death planted Sting with that stampede. And even though Missy was up on the apron, ladies and gentlemen, the doctor is back.
More information and more matches on that $100,000 tournament upcoming in the near future here on Pro Wrestling This Week. Time to journey to Memphis, Tennessee. Our good friend Lance Russell is going to bring us the play-by-play action as we watch the Rock and Roll RPMs going up against David and Eric Razor. Experience versus inexperience. We'll see what happens.
And signals for the bell to be sounded.
Jerry Vickers, the referee, and starting out as Tommy Lane. He is the shorter, but the stockier of the two. And he's going against Keith Eric. Keith Eric and David Razor. We have never seen Razor here before. Eric taking a shot or two from Tommy Lane. There's a tag on Mike Davis. Mike and Tommy, the Rock and Roll RPM. Nice stand and drop kick. Beauty. Wrestle out of Atlanta, Georgia. They have been around a lot of places. And we have heard a lot about this team. They're a rough team also.
Well, they are. Yeah, they're not, they don't use a lot of finesse, but they have got some power. That drop kick, they just powered him down to the mat. They didn't care if it looked pretty or not. They just nailed him. Same thing there with the upper arm.
Mike Davis drops again. Count of one. He didn't get it. Eric kicked his way out of it. Keith Eric needs to get over there and tag David Razor and give him his first shot of action here on Championship Wrestling. Tommy Lane takes over. And the Rock and Roll RPMs have controlled it since the opening go. That was not long ago, but they have certainly been in control. Keith Eric kicks out again.
At tag. The two count.
Yes, sir. Tag right back to Mike Davis. Double elbow. There's a tag on David Razor. Razor comes through. Boy, and he is met with a big elbow by Mike Davis. Tag on Tommy Lane. Off the ropes, in the air, backdrop. They just kind of overwhelmed him with a little two-on-one move. And Tommy Lane, one, two, three. Rock and roll RPMs, David.
Minute 58 seconds was the time on it. Quite frankly, it was all rock and roll RPMs. Mike Davis and Tommy Lane during the match. And they wrap it up.
This week continues now as we travel to New York City.
And to the offices of senior editor of Pro Wrestling Illustrated, Mr. Bill Apter. Mr. Apter is going to bring us the ratings this week for the top 10 in the WWF, also the 10 most hated wrestlers, and then he has some interesting commentary regarding Colonel DeBeers. Bill, it's all yours.
Hello, everyone. For Pro Wrestling Illustrated magazine, I'm senior editor Bill Apter, and today, ratings for the World Wrestling Federation and also Pro Wrestling Illustrated's most hated list. Right now, let's take a look at the WWF ratings. And now, the top 10 on Pro Wrestling Illustrated's most hated list. Although he's not number one on Pro Wrestling Illustrated's most hated list, Colonel DeBeers certainly is number one on my personal most hated list. Why? Because Colonel DeBeers comes around going on television things and preaching these South African apartheid views. Who does he think he is? The youth of this country being subjected to watching this maniac, Colonel DeBeers, and his brainwashing treatment of this apartheid on national television? Yes. This is America. He's got a right to say what he wants. But let me tell you something, Colonel DeBeers. You're a very stupid man. First of all, you say that Jimmy Superfly Snuka, who you recently injured, is a black man, and that black men and other minorities have no place in this country or in the world, as a matter of fact. They do have a place, A, and B, Jimmy Snuka is not a black man. Jimmy Snuka is a Polynesian man. He's from the Fiji Islands, okay? Can you understand that? Thank goodness that there are men like Jimmy Superfly Snuka, Kurt Hennig, Greg Gagne. I'm really getting upset about this, man, because with men like this, with Hennig and Snuka and Gagne, they're going to show you, Colonel DeBeers, that the minority you talk about is that you are the minority and not them. They're going to run you out of this country and show who the true minority is. Next week, world class ratings, tag team ratings, and a special editorial on Brian Adias, a man who has gone completely crazy in the world class area. I'm sorry for my attitude here, but Colonel DeBeers is really... What can I say? Now back to Joe and Gordon. Thank you very much. See you at the matches.
Well, I don't think there are too many Americans out there who would disagree with those comments from Bill Apter on Colonel DeBeers. We'll have more from Pro Wrestling Illustrated magazine next week, right here on Pro Wrestling This Week. Right now, though, it's time to go to the World Class Wrestling Association for this week's Ring Report. It's a rundown of the big events at the Reunion Arena Thanksgiving night. Kevin Von Erich was able to defend his heavyweight title against Black Bart. He kept that title there in the Reunion Arena. The Dingo Warrior and Master G in a terrific chain match. The Dingo Warrior came out on top. Mike and Lance Von Erich defeated Born and Adias in a new tag team being formed there. We saw Simpson go against the Crusher and a time limit draw. Simpson not able to take that TV title. The Grappler won, beat Mark Youngblood. Casey beat Tim Brooks at Scott Casey. And in the big match of the night, it was the Sleeper against the Clawhole. Fritz Von Erich out of retirement. The Clawhole still effective, though, as he defeated Abdullah the Butcher with the Claw. Then in a lights out match, Al Madrill and Kevin Von Erich. Al Madrill takes the title, takes the lights out match over Kevin Von Erich. Now, why a lights out match between Al Madrill and Kevin Von Erich? We're going to show you right now an incident that took place. It was between Brian Adias and Kerry Von Erich, but watch for Brian's new partner, Al Madrill.
Hey, I don't have a problem. I don't have anything to say to you.
This
just leave me alone.
You're talking to, man. This is your buddy. Your buddy from high school, your buddy from junior.
Von Erich, why don't you shut up and let a real man talk for a change, baby? The living legend is back, baby. That's right, Al Madrill. You know what? I'm trying to straighten you out.
Okay, I got it. I see his lips moving, but you're the one doing all the talking, aren't you, Madrill? Well, I never thought much of you anyway. And here you come out here running your mouth.
Well, let me tell you what. As long as I've wrestled here, baby, I never got to wrestle one of the Von Erich boys. Why? Why? Because you got no guts.
Thank you.
You ain't got no guts, boy. What happened? You fell off your tricycle, you stubbed your toe, and now you can't wrestle. Well, you're nothing, Von Erich. You've never been nothing, and you never will, baby.
I'll tell you what.
Take it easy with Kerry, please. Hey, take it easy.
Madrill, I am not leaving until you come to this ring. I'm going to tear you apart. Get out of here.
All right, Madrill is coming back. Can we please put a stop to this? That leg is just...
I'd wrestle him, but I don't have my wrestling gear. If I did, I'm...
The locker room is emptying to try to break this up.
Portland, Oregon recently found himself in a strange dilemma. He had a Pacific Northwest heavyweight champion in Rick the Crippler Oliver, who was injured and had not defended his title in 30 days. The issue was forced. It was the assassin going up against the Crippler Oliver, that Northwest Pacific Championship on the line. Here's what happened.
So that took the wind out of Rip Oliver. Oliver comes back with a right hand. That's the right hand that is bandaged. That's the right hand that's supposed to be broken. That's the right hand that he protested to the commission about. that he should not be forced to fight tonight because his hand is bandaged. He claims that it's broken. Ah, the assassin comes back to the right hand and nails Rip Oliver right on the chops. The assassin, however, is really hurt. He has just collapsed over here in the corner. And there's another left foot into the midsection. A right hand caught Oliver in the face. Another right hand caught Oliver in the face. And Oliver just standing there. He's just letting the assassin wail on him. Both of these men are hurt. Now, Rip Oliver took that arm pad of his. He adjusted it and smashed it up against the side of the face of the assassin. Now, you can't tell me that there's just padding in that arm pad of his. There's got to be something in there besides foam rubber or something. Oliver misses with a haymaker. He just got clotheslined by the assassin coming off the ropes. Both of these men are hurt. They're both exhausted. Neither one of them can really seize the opportunity of putting the other one away. Here comes the assassin. He got the crowd behind him. Right hand on the jaw of Rip Oliver. Puts him down. Remember, this is one fall to a finish, and the belt is on the line. The championship is on the line. Oliver taking a vicious beating now from the assassin. Right hands, left hands, right hands. Into the ropes goes Oliver, and over the ropes goes Oliver. Outside. The assassin is going outside. He's staggering around, but he's coming up to Oliver, and he's got him. And I believe it's going to be... Oh, I thought he's going to throw him into the iron post. He just hits him with his iron fist. Now, another right hand staggers Oliver. Another right hand. Oliver's still standing. He's still... Now, where's the assassin going with him? He's got a chair out there. He smashes Oliver face first down into that metal folding chair. Oliver was just smashed face first into the chair. The assassin and Oliver outside, they've been counted out outside the ring. They're into the crowd. They're beyond the crowd. They're heading back towards the dressing room. They're out of our sight. I can only tell by the reaction of the crowd that the assassin must be getting in some pretty good licks. Well, both men were counted out outside the ring. Now,
well, you can bet the Masked Assassin is going to be demanding more title matches now with Rip Oliver. Right now, it's time to go to our NWA ring report concerning Thanksgiving night and Starrcade 86. A rundown of some of the top matches of that night. Brad Armstrong, in one of the most exciting matches of the night, went to a time limit draw with gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, and I might add, one of the most beautiful sights of the night was Precious at ringside. Wahoo McDaniel defeated Rick Rude in that Indian strap match. He still hasn't lost one of those. The Russians defeated the Jayhawks. The crowd not very happy with how it happened, but the Russians keep the U.S. titles. Jimmy Valiant able to defeat Paul Jones. Jones' head was shaved bald right there in front of that capacity crowd. The Rock and Roll Express defeated the Andersons in a cage to keep the World Tag Team titles. Dusty Rhodes, in that First Blood match, lost the World TV title to Tully Blanchard. And Ric Flair and Nikita Koloff went to a double disqualification. The wrestlers from the dressing room literally had to come and tear these two apart. A lot of animosity between Nikita Koloff and Ric Flair. And in one of the most exciting matches I've ever seen, a scaffold match, it was the Road Warriors defeating the Midnight Express when both members of the Midnight Express were thrown off that scaffold. It was an exciting match. As we said, one of the most exciting ones we've ever seen.
Well, the PWTW remote crew was on hand at the Omni for the Starrcade this past Thanksgiving. Joe Pedicino had a chance to talk to the Road Warriors immediately following their victory.
And one of the most exciting matches that we've ever seen at Starrcade 86, it was the scaffold match, and we're with the victors, the Road Warriors.
That's right, all you people out there, you see, we kick butt on the Midnight Express and Jim Cornette. It's just too bad that Bubba wasn't around. You know, we're the greatest wrestlers in the world, and that's why we're on this guy's program. It's one of the greatest programs in the world. So that's why he's got the Road Warriors with our manager, Precious Paul, out here. Tonight, Atlanta, Georgia, we, the Road Warriors, take on only the toughest competition and wrestle only the toughest types of matches in wrestling history. And tonight, we prove not only to the Midnight Express, but to the whole world, we're the masters of the scaffold match. Tell them, Hawk.
Hey, I got a taste in my mouth that I'm savoring. It's just not the victory. Nah, that's just another one we can chuck up in the Legion of Doom's books. I got a little taste of Dennis Condrey's blood right in my mouth, right when I sucked it out of his forehead. Now listen up, people. You want scaffold matches? The Warriors give them to you. We say we're going to win, and we do win. We've always said there are two kinds of people, weasels and weasel slappers. Well, we ain't no weasels. Take it, Paul.
Starrcade 86, and a most interesting interview with those men.
It was an interesting conversation, Gordon. And speaking of interesting conversations, Gordon Solie had one this week in Birmingham, Alabama, with Kevin Sullivan, the Mystic. You know, we showed you last week how Kevin and his headhunters took the whole $100,000 away from that big tournament they had, and not exactly making Scott Armstrong and Steve Armstrong very happy. Let's go find out how Steve is going to get that money back.
Well, I came up with a series of matches that I want this pole, the $100,000 to be on it, winner take all. But Mr. Armstrong went again to some source that I don't know, but I have a pretty good indication who it may be, Mr. Solie. I hope you get my drift. And now they're going to have a series of matches, seven of them all, in seven continental cities throughout the United States. And the one that wins four, like the World Series, will win the $100,000.
The best four out of seven, that's correct. In other words, this is going to be the scene of one of these if the person who wins this one has the start going to win three more.
It's amazing how you know everything about this, Mr. Solie, when I thought I was the only one besides Armstrong that knew this. But let me tell you this, young Steve Armstrong, you see, there's seven of these in seven cities. But the way I came up with this, Mr. Solie, you may find this interesting. In Calcutta, when they find a thief or a wife stealer, something of that effect, you see, in Calcutta, the Sultan himself sits there, and they draw a pit. And in this pit, they put a pole. And the pole, the first man that crawls up the pole and out of the pit, is innocent of all crimes. But lo and behold, the man that's left in the pit, Mr. Solie, is stoned to death. And then his fingers are cut off and taken downtown and let everybody see his shame. Steve Armstrong, it's a good thing that this is the Western Hemisphere. It's a good thing you haven't come to my backyard. You haven't gone the Asian way, because I would love it to be in a pit with the pole. But now, no, we're going American style, Mr. Solie. And what this means is that I get to beat on your head seven different times. You see in the envelope up here, there'll be a number 1 through 7. Whoever gets four of the numbers is the winner. Is that true, Mr. Solie?
That's very true.
Mr. Solie, you seem to me that maybe somebody else got with Steve Armstrong and designed the series of matches. I only wanted it once, and I hope you get my drift. You see, Steve Armstrong, don't align yourself with other people, because I may make it Calcutta style. I may break all seven fingers.
WTW continues now with the WWF Ring Report.
Gordon, in the WWF, the big news this week, three stories. The first one, Andre the Giant has been located. He was in London, England, filming a motion picture, and now he's ready to come back to the WWF. President Frank Tooney says the suspension will be lifted, and Andre will be allowed back in. Bobby Heenan, not very happy about that. He is very happy, though, about the acquisition of Hercules Hernandez. Bobby was able to complete his financial deal with Slick and now owns the contract of Hercules, just in time, I might add, to have Hercules lose to Hulk Hogan on Saturday night's main event last week in the main event of that show. Also on that program, a very unusual match with Randy Savage taking on Jake the Snake Roberts. Two rule breakers in action. It ended up with both men counted out of the ring. The big event, though, in the WWF this week was the return of Adrian Adonis. In Piper's Pit, it was Piper standing there having words, you might say, with Jimmy Hart, when all of a sudden, from behind, Adrian Adonis comes in. He attacks Piper with a crutch and puts Piper in that famous Adonis sleeper hold, leaving Piper laying on the floor and just walking away. You know Roddy Piper. He's not going to put up with that, and I'm sure in the future weeks we'll have more on the Piper-Adonis situation in the WWF, and that is our WWF World Wrestling Federation Ring Report for this week.
And now the time is 1963. The location, Detroit, Michigan. The occasion, a wrestling match between The Sheik and Sam Schell. The Sheik, of course, in the 60s, the absolute scourge of the wrestling world. Our Matt Classic this week takes us back to 1963 in this match between The Sheik and Sam Schell.
The Sheik, the most frightful man in professional wrestling today. The man who strikes fear into the hearts of fans and wrestlers alike all over the world. Les went out head first. I hope he didn't hit his head. Brother, he went out head first. I don't think he hit his head, luckily. But he came close to it. The Sheik's out on the floor after him, throwing him right into the ring post in the corner. And what need I say about the Sheik going after a chair? This is just totally uncalled for. Totally uncalled for. The Sheik will stop at nothing, nothing at all, to injure, to destroy his opponents. That is his entire purpose of entering the ring, not to wrestle, but to injure, to end the careers of his opponents, to devastate them, to destroy them. What a rat this Creechman is, too. You saw him throw Schell back in. Schell, of course, had a count of 20 on the floor to get back into the ring. The Creechman wouldn't let him wait out the count, threw him right back into the ring. The fans are calling for Dory Funk Jr. He is in the studio today. Not in the studio, he is in the building. I think he will keep his keep himself out of the studio, though, because I'm sure if Dory Funk Jr. were to see the Sheik, he couldn't control himself. And, of course, if Dory were to start anything with the Sheik today, there would be fines and possibly suspension. So Dory is probably somewhere where he can't even see what's going on with the Sheik. I'm sorry you can't see the capabilities of Sam Schell, but he is just being outclassed by the Sheik. Just being outclassed by him. He's a very capable, skillful young wrestler. They're still calling for Dory Funk. They want Dory
Funk. Your business. You don't gonna get Dory Funk. I got big news for you. You idiots, what you are.
Yeah, well, if you're idiots, I don't know what that makes you, Creechman. The Sheik with the forearm to the back of Schell. Schell has just not had a chance to do anything. He's been zero during this entire bout. Such is the contrast between Schell and the Sheik. And the Sheik with his famous camel clutch, that is it.
Fire and snakes, they go with the Sheik.
Absolutely, Gordon. Right now, it's time to go to Minneapolis, Minnesota, to Donna. She's got this week's ring report from the American Wrestling Association.
Upset does not describe Sherry Martel, more like outraged for being excluded from a magazine's recent poll of the 10 most sexiest females in America. And just to prove there's been a grave error, or perhaps even tampering, by the number one seated Cybill Shepherd, Sherry is demanding a recount of votes to prove she is the undisputed sexiest female in America, or perhaps even the world, according to her. Well, it looks as if the Sheik is going for that added jewel to his belly button. This time, he is attempting to buy up the majority supply of the new U.S. American Eagle $50 gold coin. Of course, with backers such as friend Adnan Khashoggi, world's richest man, along with his OPEC oil friends, he feels he should have no problem. And should the Sheik accomplish this golden task? Well, it would mean one step closer to his goal of dominating the U.S. money supply. Greg Gagne, whose proven public image portrays that of the clean-cut, all-American boy, may just be the next candidate to appear on the cover of the Wheaties cereal box. Greg, who advocates a healthy body and a clear mind free of chemicals, consistently warns the youth of America against the use of alcohol and drugs. He feels this is such a vital issue, we must educate our young people now. His motto, get ahead, not dead.
Well, it'll be interesting to see Greg on a box of Wheaties.
Yes, Gordon, it will.
Okay, I'll tell you what. We're going to let the stations make a little money right now, and then we'll be back with more of Pro Wrestling This Week.
Who was going to be the wrestler of the week? We decided it was Ben Bazarab. After all, he went into the ring on an obvious two-on-one situation in an entire tag match, knowing he wouldn't have a partner and it would be two-on-one. Let's go back and relive just a few seconds of that match.
Oh, really? Did you see that? He jammed that martial arts stick right into the neck of Ben Bazarab.
He didn't see it.
And look at this. Look at this.
Before we leave, a very special welcome one more time to our new viewers in Los Angeles watching on KCOP Channel 13 every Saturday morning. We're sure you're going to love the action every week right here on Pro Wrestling This Week. I'm Joe Pedicino.
And I'm Gordon Zoli saying please join us again next week here on Pro Wrestling This Week.
I don't think there are too many Americans out there who would disagree with those comments from Bill Apter on Colonel DeBeers. We'll have more from Pro Wrestling Illustrated Magazine next week right here on Pro Wrestling This Week. Right now, though, it's time to go to the World Class Wrestling Association for this week's Ring Report. It's a rundown of the big events at the Reunion Arena Thanksgiving night. Kevin Von Erich was able to defend his heavyweight title against Black Bart. He kept that title there in the Reunion Arena. The Dingo Warrior and Master G in a terrific chain match. The Dingo Warrior came out on top. Mike and Lance Von Erich defeated Born and Adias in a new tag team being formed there. We saw Simpson go against the Crusher and a time limit draw. Simpson not able to take that TV title. The Grappler won, beat Mark Youngblood. Casey beat Tim Brooks at Scott Casey. And in the big match of the night, it was the Sleeper against the Clawhole. Fritz Von Erich out of retirement. The Clawhole still effective, though, as he defeated Abdullah the Butcher with the Claw. Then in a lights out match, Al Madrill and Kevin Von Erich. Al Madrill takes the title, takes the lights out match over Kevin Von Erich. Now, why a lights out match between Al Madrill and Kevin Von Erich? We're going to show you right now an incident that took place. It was between Brian Adias and Kerry Von Erich, but watch for Brian's new partner, Al Madrill.
Hey, I don't have a problem. I don't have anything to say to you.
This
just leave me alone.
You're talking to, man. This is your buddy. Your buddy from high school, your buddy from junior.
Von Erich, why don't you shut up and let a real man talk for a change, baby? The living legend is back, baby. That's right, Al Madrill. You know what? I'm trying to straighten you out.
Okay, I got it. I see his lips moving, but you're the one doing all the talking, aren't you, Madrill? Well, I never thought much of you anyway. And here you come out here running your mouth.
Well, let me tell you what. As long as I've wrestled here, baby, I never got to wrestle one of the Von Erich boys. Why? Why? Because you got no guts.
Thank
you. You ain't got no guts, boy. What happened? You fell off your tricycle, you stubbed your toe, and now you can't wrestle. Well, you're nothing, Von Erich. You've never been nothing, and you never will, baby.
Take it easy with Kerry, please. Hey, take it easy.
Of it. make big money. You want to do something? Hit him, baby. Hit him.
Oh, this is awful.
Madrill, I am not leaving until you come to this ring. I'm going to tear you apart. Get out of here.
All right, Madrill is coming back. Can we please put a stop to this? That leg is just...
I'd wrestle him, but I don't have my wrestling gear. If I did, I'm going to...
The locker room is emptying to try to break this up.
Portland, Oregon recently found himself in a strange dilemma. He had a Pacific Northwest heavyweight champion in Rick the Crippler Oliver, who was injured and had not defended his title in 30 days. The issue was forced. It was the assassin going up against the Crippler Oliver, that Northwest Pacific Championship on the line. Here's what happened.
So that took the wind out of Rip Oliver. Oliver comes back with a right hand. That's the right hand that is bandaged. That's the right hand that's supposed to be broken. That's the right hand that he protested to the commission about, that he should not be forced to fight tonight because his hand is bandaged. He claims that it's broken. Ah, the assassin comes back with the right hand and nails Rip Oliver right on the chops. The assassin, however, he is really hurt. He has just collapsed over here in the corner, and there's another left foot into the midsection. A right hand caught Oliver in the face. Another right hand caught Oliver in the face, and Oliver just standing there. He's just letting the assassin wail on him. Both of these men are now. What? Rip Oliver took that arm pad of his. He adjusted it and smashed it up against the side of the face of the assassin. Now, you can't tell me that there's just padding in that arm pad of his. There's got to be something in there besides foam rubber or something. Oliver misses with a haymaker. He just got clotheslined by the assassin coming off the ropes. Both of these men are hurt. They're both exhausted. Neither one of them can really seize the opportunity of putting the other one away. Here comes the assassin. He got the crowd behind him. Right hand on the jaw of Rip Oliver. Puts him down. Remember, this is one fall to a finish, and the belt is on the line. The championship is on the line. Oliver taking a vicious beating now from the assassin. Right hands, left hands, right hands. Into the ropes goes Oliver, and over the ropes goes Oliver outside. The assassin is going outside. He's staggering around, but he's coming up to Oliver, and he's got him. And I believe it's going to be... Oh, I thought he's going to throw him into the iron post. He just hits him with his iron fist. Now, another right hand staggers Oliver. Another right hand. Oliver's still standing. He's still... Now, where's the assassin going with him? He's got a chair out there. He smashes Oliver face first down into that metal folding chair. Oliver was just smashed face first into the chair. The assassin and Oliver outside, they've been counted out outside the ring. They're into the crowd. They're beyond the crowd. They're heading back towards the dressing room. They're out of our sight. I can only tell by the reaction of the crowd that the assassin must be getting in some pretty good licks. Oh, man. Well, both men were counted out outside the ring. Now,
Well, you can bet the Masked Assassin is going to be demanding more title matches now with Rip Oliver. Right now, it's time to go to our NWA ring report concerning Thanksgiving night and Starrcade 86. Our run. Now, while I was there, I was introduced to a newcomer. His name, Jason the Terrible. He's very impressive. Let's go to our international match of the week from San Juan, Puerto Rico, as we see Jason the Terrible take on Charlie Camper.
Queridos amigos, vamos a presentar a continuación este encuentro pactado a una caída o 10 minutos de duración. Inmediatamente en la esquina técnica, pesando 225 libras, de la Florida, Charles Camper. En la esquina rudísima, con 270 libras de peso y de un lugar desconocido, Jason el Terrible. Su apoderado, Chiqui Star, árbitro Ricky Vargas Beníquez.
Padín, y rápidamente entró a la carga este señor Jason el Terrible, pero ha sido sorprendido por Charles Camper, pero se recupera Jason el Terrible. Y yo creo que se ha metido en un problema este señor Charles Camper. Enfrentarse con esta amenaza humana en ese cuadrilátero es algo bastante difícil.
Ahí está el castigo violento por parte del Terrible. Y el castigo, diríamos que es verdaderamente terrible. ¡Avi María, tremendo! En plena cintura. Le abrió la cintura, aparentemente. Ahí está el rodillazo en ella misma por parte de Jason el Terrible, dominando terriblemente a su adversario técnico, también procedente de la Florida. Ahí está Jason el Terrible tomando por el pelo a Charles Camper. Viene con él, mis amigos. ¡Ah, lanza de esquina contra Camper! Vuelve Jason el Terrible a tomar la iniciativa sobre su adversario, lo impulsa. Ahí está una guindolina, mis amigos. Parece que va a ser todo, efectivamente, mis amigos. Acaba de rendirlo. Acabó de rendirlo, mis amigos. Ahí lo tienen alto y se acabó el encuentro. Victoria para Jason el Terrible.
Jason the Terrible, impressive indeed with that backbreaker. Let's move along now to the greater Atlanta area and deep south wrestling, where Tommy Wildfire Rich brought in quite a challenge to the Masked Assassin. That challenge was in the form of Grizzly Boone. Let's take a look at what happens to the Assassin when he meets Grizzly Boone.
Well, the Assassin claims that Dirty Rhodes has taken care of Big Bubba and that Big Bubba's not going to be here tonight.
Well, see, if I didn't know but one person, that may be a problem. But like I said, I had two or three different people that wanted to collect that money. $25, big money, but they wanted to come get you. So whether, whether Big Bubba's here, it don't matter. Because like I said, I got something for you, and I guarantee you, he gonna yank that mask right off of your head, Jack. Yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah.
Nick, it's two on one. What is Tommy Rich doing?
I don't know. I got out of the way of that one quick.
They've got
him.
He's
in big trouble. Oh, no, he's in the ring with both of them. Dirty Rhodes. Wait a minute. Grizzly Boone.
Grizzly Boone.
What's Grizzly Boone doing out here?
Grizzly Boone.
He just nailed Dirty Rhodes, and he's coming in. Well, the Assassin's going over him. Whoa.
Now he's gone in. This is the surprise Bobby Rich had. Look at him pick up the assassin. Oh no! Here comes the he's got him!
Splash.
He's got it! Now he's going after the mask. And down on the floor, we've got Dirty Rhodes, who got hit with that knocker and is still down.
He just walked up and bumped him right on the top of the head. Dropped
he's
him
going
like
after the
habit.
Mask.
Uh-oh.
He's got it. He's getting it off.
Uh-oh.
He's getting it off.
This will be it for the Assassin.
This will be it. We're finally going to get
the mask.
He got it.
He got the mask.
He got the mask off.
We can see his face.
The mask. Wait a minute. Get the camera on him.
I can't see his face. Dirty Rhodes.
Get the camera on the Assassin.
Dirty Rhodes has pulled that top shirt up over his head. I don't think I didn't get a good look at his face.
Tommy. If Tommy Rich had just been thinking, they could have gone over and they could have grabbed him. The cameraman's even walking out.
Oh, mercy. He got that mask.
What a surprise Tommy Rich had for the Assassin.
I
want to find out how Dirty Rhodes took care of Big Bubba.
That
Did he pay him off? Did he hurt him? What happened? But look at what Tommy Rich had standing by just in case. We haven't seen Grizzly Boone in a few months here in Deep South, but when he comes back, he comes back.
pro wrestling this week. I think the assassin's going to have his hands full with this fellow Grizzly Boone. And I'll tell you what, we've had our hands full for the past couple of weeks with Michael Hayes.
Well, you know, we've been telling you for the past couple of weeks that Michael Hayes wanted to do a special segment for pro wrestling this week. We were calling it P.S. Michael Hayes Postscript. He just determined to call it P.S. Rumors. You know, we don't like to deal so much with rumors here on pro wrestling this week. We prefer to give facts. But with Michael Hayes, sometimes facts and rumors sway over the line, shall we say? Let's go to the first initial segment of Michael Hayes, and let's call it P.S. Rumors.
Hello, ladies. Hello, everybody who watches pro wrestling this week. You know something, baby? It seems that my man, Joe Pettisito, he's been doing a real good job of covering wrestling from all over. But see, lately he's been hampered by the fact of the influxuation of mail coming to his offices and trying to read and answer all these letters of people saying, we've got to know more about the UWF. We've got to know more about the Universal Wrestling Federation. Well, who would be better than yours truly, Michael P.S. Purely Sexy, and I think it speaks for itself, Hayes, than to give you the lowdown on the biggest thing in professional wrestling, the UWF. I mean, man, I'm one third of the Fabulous Freebirds, the greatest thing that ever hit wrestling. We're sitting on top of the UWF, the greatest wrestling organization that there is, man. And right here on the show that catches you up with everything. Like I said, Joe Pettisito, baby, I know you've been trying hard, but you know, just like Jim Ross was trying hard, he had to have P.S.'s help. And y'all don't feel bad because there's other people. And see, I'm going to have a lot of insight for y'all. I'm going to have some special interviews. But even if I don't, me is special enough.
Well, it looks like we're going to have our hands full with Michael Hayes every week. It'll be interesting to see who his guest star on upcoming weeks of P.S. Rumors. Right now, it's time for a rundown of what happened in New Orleans on Thanksgiving night at the big Popeye Spectacular with the UWF. The one-man gang was able to hold on to his heavyweight title, and then, what a night, he also won the $100,000 Battle Royal, that big two-ring Battle Royal. In the double cage match that night, Dr. Death was able to defeat Michael Hayes in a steel cage, and at the same time in a barbed wire cage, Terry Taylor defeated Buddy Roberts. A great night, over 13,000 people there at the Superdome, the largest crowd for a wrestling event in 3 years at the Superdome in New Orleans. Some sad news now from the UWF. Hollywood John Tatum in a serious car accident this week in Shreveport, Louisiana. He came out with two broken legs and some internal injuries. Now, in the past few days, he has taken a turn for the better. The doctors say the legs were broken cleanly, and they should heal in 2 to 3 months, and we should be seeing Hollywood John Tatum back in action at about that time. Now, also in the UWF, the big Pro Wrestling Illustrated tournament going on, that $100,000 tournament. This week we saw a match between Sting and Dr. Death Steve Williams. Let's take a look at just how that match came about.
It proved a great deal. Taking it to Steve, Dr. Death Williams. Sting showing some offensive brilliance here on Universal Wrestling. An elbow squarely to the chest of Dr. Death, and that flying fist. Sting, if you ever notice his elevation, he really gets up in the air on that maneuver. And that one, elbow, and it caught Dr. Death. Sting going for the kill here. But he didn't grapevine the leg, and I don't care how strong he is, he's not going to hold Dr. Death down that way, nor is anyone else. Sting now up on the second rope. He's taking a long time up there. And Dr. Death raised the knee, and it met the midsection of Sting quite squarely. And Dr. Death now back on his feet, and there's a right hand that struck home. And another one, the doctor making a very physical house call here. Clothesline by the doctor, Dr. Death Steve Williams. Dr. Death, a little bit hesitant in that lateral press. Oh, my gosh. What a forearm. And Dr. Death now. And another one. Nice reversal by Sting. Sting with a clothesline to Dr. Death in the corner. That's an unusual maneuver. But Missy Hyatt's up on that on the ring apron for no apparent reason. I wish they wouldn't even let her at ringside. Dr. Death, what a stampede! Dr. Death with a modified stampede, but he got it. And Fergie is preoccupied, as are a lot of men, with Missy Hyatt. But Dr. Death planted Sting with that stampede. And even though Missy was up on the apron, ladies and gentlemen, the doctor is back.
More information and more matches on that $100,000 tournament upcoming in the near future here on Pro Wrestling This Week. Time to journey to Memphis, Tennessee. Our good friend Lance Russell is going to bring us the play-by-play action as we watch the Rock and Roll RPMs going up against David and Eric Razor. Experience versus inexperience. We'll see what happens.
And signals for the bell to be sounded.
Jerry Vickers, the referee, and starting out as Tommy Lane. He is the shorter, but the stockier of the two. And he's going against Keith Eric. Keith Eric and David Razor. We have never seen Razor here before. Eric taking a shot or two from Tommy Lane. There's a tag on Mike Davis. Mike and Tommy, the Rock and Roll RPM. Nice stand and drop kick. Beauty. Wrestle out of Atlanta, Georgia. They have been around a lot of places. And we have heard a lot about this team. They're a rough team also.
Well, they are. Yeah, they're not, they don't use a lot of finesse, but they have got some power. That drop kick, they just powered him down to the mat. They didn't care if it looked pretty or not. They just nailed him. Same thing there with the upper arm.
Mike Davis drops again. Count of one. He didn't get it. Eric kicked his way out of it. Keith Eric needs to get over there and tag David Razor and give him his first shot of action here on Championship Wrestling. Tommy Lane takes over. And the Rock and Roll RPMs have controlled it since the opening go. That was not long ago, but they have certainly been in control. Keith Eric kicks out again.
At the two count.
Yes, sir. Tag right back to Mike Davis. Double elbow. There's a tag on David Razor. Razor comes through. Boy, and he is met with a big elbow by Mike Davis. Tag on Tommy Lane. Off the ropes, in the air, backdrop. They just kind of overwhelmed him with a little two-on-one move. And Tommy Lane, one, two, three. Rock and Roll RPMs, David.
Minute 58 seconds was the time on it. Quite frankly, it was all Rock and Roll RPMs. Mike Davis and Tommy Lane during the match.
This week continues now as we travel to New York City.
And to the offices of senior editor of Pro Wrestling Illustrated, Mr. Bill Apter. Mr. Apter is going to bring us the ratings this week for the top 10 in the WWF, also the 10 most hated wrestlers, and then he has some interesting commentary regarding Colonel De Beers. Bill, it's all yours.
Hello, everyone. For Pro Wrestling Illustrated magazine, I'm senior editor Bill Apter, and today, ratings for the World Wrestling Federation and also Pro Wrestling Illustrated's most hated list. Right now, let's take a look at the WWF ratings. And now, the top 10 on Pro Wrestling Illustrated's most hated list. Although he's not number one on Pro Wrestling Illustrated's most hated list, Colonel De Beers certainly is number one on my personal most hated list. Why? Because Colonel De Beers comes around going on television things and preaching these South African apartheid views. Who does he think he is? The youth of this country being subjected to watching this maniac, Colonel De Beers, and his brainwashing treatment of this apartheid on national television? Yes, this is America. He's got a right to say what he wants. But let me tell you something, Colonel De Beers. You're a very stupid man. First of all, you say that Jimmy Superfly Snuka, who you recently injured, is a black man, and that black men and other minorities have no place in this country or in the world, as a matter of fact. They do have a place, A, and B, Jimmy Snuka is not a black man. Jimmy Snuka is a Polynesian man. He's from the Fiji Islands, okay? Can you understand that? Thank goodness that there are men like Jimmy Superfly Snuka, Kurt Hennig, Greg Gagne. I'm really getting upset about this, man, because with men like this, with Hennig and Snuka and Gagne, they're going to show you, Colonel De Beers, that the minority you talk about is that you are the minority and not them. They're going to run you out of this country and show who the true minority is. Next week, world-class ratings, tag team ratings, and a special editorial on Brian Adias, a man who has gone completely crazy in the world-class area. I'm sorry for my attitude here, but Colonel De Beers is really, what can I say? Now back to Joe and Gordon. Thank you very much. See you at the matches.
Down of some of the top matches of that night. Brad Armstrong, in one of the most exciting matches of the night, went to a time limit draw with gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, and I might add, one of the most beautiful sights of the night was Precious at ringside. Wahoo McDaniel defeated Rick Rude in that Indian strap match. He still hasn't lost one of those. The Russians defeated the Jayhawks. The crowd not very happy with how it happened, but the Russians keep the U.S. titles. Jimmy Valiant able to defeat Paul Jones. Jones' head was shaved bald right there in front of that capacity crowd. The Rock and Roll Express defeated the Andersons in a cage to keep the World Tag Team titles. Dusty Rhodes, in that First Blood match, lost the World TV title to Tully Blanchard. And Ric Flair and Nikita Koloff went to a double disqualification. The wrestlers from the dressing room literally had to come and tear these two apart. A lot of animosity between Nikita Koloff and Ric Flair. And in one of the most exciting matches I've ever seen, a scaffold match, it was the Road Warriors defeating the Midnight Express when both members of the Midnight Express were thrown off that scaffold. It was an exciting match. As we said, one of the most exciting ones we've ever seen.
Well, the PWTW remote crew was on hand at the Omni for the Starcade this past Thanksgiving. Joe Pedicino had a chance to talk to the Road Warriors immediately following their victory.
And one of the most exciting matches that we've ever seen at Starcade 86, it was the scaffold match, and we're with the victors, the Road Warriors.
That's right, all you people out there, you see, we kick butt on the Midnight Express and Jim Cornette. It's just too bad that Bubba wasn't around. You know, we're the greatest wrestlers in the world, and that's why we're on this guy's program. It's one of the greatest programs in the world. So that's why he's got the Road Warriors with our manager, Precious Paul, out here. Tonight, Atlanta, Georgia, we, the Road Warriors, take on only the toughest competition and wrestle only the toughest types of matches in wrestling history. And tonight, we prove not only to the Midnight Express, but to the whole world, we're the masters of the scaffold match. Tell them, Hawk.
Hey, I got a taste in my mouth that I'm savoring. It's just not the victory. Nah, that's just another one we could chuck up in the Legion of Doom's books. I got a little taste of Dennis Condrey's blood right in my mouth, right when I sucked it out of his forehead. Now listen up, people. You want scaffold matches? The Warriors give them to you. We say we're going to win, and we do win. We've always said there are two kinds of people, weasels and weasel slappers. Well, we ain't no weasels. Take it, Paul.
Starcade 86, and a most interesting interview with those men.
It was an interesting conversation, Gordon. And speaking of interesting conversations, Gordon Solie had one this week in Birmingham, Alabama, with Kevin Sullivan, the Mystic. You know, we showed you last week how Kevin and his headhunters took the whole $100,000 away from that big tournament they had, and not exactly making Scott Armstrong and Steve Armstrong very happy. Let's go find out how Steve is going to get that money back.
Well, I came up with a series of matches that I want this pole, the $100,000 to be on it, winner take all. But Mr. Armstrong went again to some source that I don't know, but I have a pretty good indication who it may be, Mr. Soley. I hope you get my drift. And now they're going to have a series of matches, seven of them all, in seven continental cities throughout the United States. And the one that wins four, like the World Series, will win the $100,000.
The best four out of seven, that's correct. In other words, this is going to be the scene of one of these. if the person who wins this one has the start going to win three more.
It's amazing how you know everything about this, Mr. Soli, when I thought I was the only one besides Armstrong that knew this. But let me tell you this, young Steve Armstrong, you see, there's seven of these in seven cities. But the way I came up with this, Mr. Soli, you may find this interesting. In Calcutta, when they find a thief or a wife stealer, something of that effect, you see, in Calcutta, the Sultan himself sits there, and they draw a pit. And in this pit, they put a pole. And the pole, the first man that crawls up the pole and out of the pit, is innocent of all crimes. But lo and behold, the man that's left in the pit, Mr. Soli, is stoned to death. And then his fingers are cut off and taken downtown and let everybody see his shame. Steve Armstrong, it's a good thing that this is the Western Hemisphere. It's a good thing you haven't come to my backyard. You haven't gone the Asian way. Because I would love it to be in a pit with the pole. But now, no, we're going American style, Mr. Soli. And what this means is that I get to beat on your head seven different times. You see in the envelope up here, there'll be a number 1 through 7. Whoever gets 4 of the numbers is the winner. Is that true, Mr. Soli?
That's very true.
Mr. Soli, you seem to me that maybe somebody else got with Steve Armstrong and designed the series of matches. I only wanted it once, and I hope you get my drift. You see, Steve Armstrong, don't align yourself with other people because I may make it Calcutta style. I may break all 7 figures.
WTW continues now with the WWF Ring Report.
Gordon, in the WWF, the big news this week, 3 stories. The first one, Andre the Giant has been located. He was in London, England, filming a motion picture, and now he's ready to come back to the WWF. President Frank Tooney says the suspension will be lifted, and Andre will be allowed back in. Bobby Heenan, not very happy about that. He is very happy, though, about the acquisition of Hercules Hernandez. Bobby was able to complete his financial deal with Slick and now owns the contract of Hercules, just in time, I might add, to have Hercules lose to Hulk Hogan on Saturday night's main event last week in the main event of that show. Also on that program, a very unusual match with Randy Savage taking on Jake the Snake Roberts. 2 rule breakers in action. It ended up with both men counted out of the ring. The big event, though, in the WWF this week was the return of Adrian Adonis. In Piper's Pit, it was Piper standing there having words, you might say, with Jimmy Hart, when all of a sudden, from behind, Adrian Adonis comes in. He attacks Piper with a crutch and puts Piper in that famous Adonis sleeper hold, leaving Piper laying on the floor and just walking away. You know Roddy Piper. He's not going to put up with that, and I'm sure in the future weeks we'll have more on the Piper-Adonis situation in the WWF, and that is our WWF World Wrestling Federation Ring Report for this week.
And now the time is 1963. The location, Detroit, Michigan. The occasion, a wrestling match between the Sheik and Sam Schell. The Sheik, of course, in the 60s, the absolute scourge of the wrestling world. Our Matt Classic this week takes us back to 1963 in this match between the Sheik and Sam Schell.
The Sheik, the most frightful man in professional wrestling today. The man who strikes fear into the hearts of fans and wrestlers alike all over the world. West went out head first. I hope he didn't hit his head. Brother, he went out head first. I don't think he hit.
Guys, take it easy.
Hit him! Hit him! You want to make big money? You want to do something? Hit him, baby! Hit him!
We'll be right back.
and welcome to Pro Wrestling This Week. I'm Joe Pedicino.
And I'm Gordon Solie, and we do have indeed an interesting hour in store for you. We're going to be going to the Calgary Stampede Wrestling. We'll also be traveling to San Juan, Puerto Rico, to Portland, Oregon, to Birmingham, Alabama, to the greater Atlanta area. We'll also be having ring reports about the great Thanksgiving matches that occurred all around the country. Our Matt Classic this week concerns one of the fiercest competitors the world has ever seen. I'm referring, of course, to the Sheik. That Matt Classic goes back to 1963. This and much, much more upcoming, Joe.
That's right. You know, Gordon, we're going to start off, as you said, in Calgary. But before we go there, a very special hello to all of our new viewers in Los Angeles, California, watching us now every Saturday morning at 9:30 on KCOP. A very special hello to all of our new California viewers. As we said, we were going to start off in Calgary, Canada. It was supposed to be a tag team match, Owen Hart and Ben Bazarab going up against the Viet Cong Express 1 and 2. But before they could get to the ring, J.R. Foley and his army attacked the team and literally put Owen Hart in the hospital. He had to be carried away. That left Ben Bazarab to go against the Viet Cong Express alone. We're going to join this match in progress now. It's a two-on-one situation. Ben Bazarab says he'll take them on by himself. He goes into the ring in Calgary Stampede.
Pile driver coming up. An amazing move to reverse that pile driver, but once again, interference by the second Viet Cong. Bazarab taking incredible punishment, and referee Jürgen Hermann is the subject of a lot of catcalls from this capacity crowd.
Well, into that turnbuckle, cut the clothesline in desperation.
Amazing heart, amazing guts by Ben Bazarab. Fighting an uphill battle, two against one.
Look at him, go to work.
That big drop kick and headbutt, that's really shaking up that Viet Cong, but not for long, there's the tag. You could hear that right over here.
Yes, sir.
Karate kick to the throat. Off those ropes. Look at this move by Bazarab.
Oh, really? Did you see that?
He jammed that martial arts stick right into the neck of Ben Bazarab.
He didn't see it.
And look at this.
Look at this. Hit them both. Where's the referee?
Bazarab going to town with that martial arts stick.
Well, it's cleaning house time. Cleaning house, and of course, the referee, not seeing anything, will disqualify Bazarab.
That's unbelievable.
Welcome back to Pro Wrestling This Week. You know, Gordon, a lot of wrestlers would not have gone into that ring two-on-one. Ben Bazarab, though, was so upset over what happened to his partner, Owen Hart, that he said, yes, I'll take on the Viet Cong Express by myself. And I might add, he didn't do too bad of a job.
Very true, Joe, no question about it. Right now, we're going to travel south of the border to San Juan, Puerto Rico, where Joe Pedicino was recently the guest of the World Wrestling Council, was on hand in San Juan to present the Wrestler of the Month Award to a well-deserving competitor, Invader Number One. Let's see how this interview goes.
Well, Hugo, obviously the fans here love Invader One. Everyone knows the Invader Number One, one of the greatest heroes in the wrestling world. And in my travels, in my position, I travel around the world seeing the finest wrestlers in the world every day of the week. It's my pleasure to be here today to present to the Invader One from the World Wrestling Council this plaque. And I would like to at this time read the plaque and present it to the Invader.
Let me translate to the fans first what we were
saying. All right.
Para traducir lo que dice el vicepresidente del Consejo Mundial, para él es un orgullo venir a Puerto Rico para hacer entrega de esta placa como luchador del mes de octubre al Invader 1, al viaje alrededor del mundo. Y este es un privilegio que él viene aquí para presentar esta placa y va a leer la siguiente, lo que dice.
The World Wrestling Council proudly awards the Puerto Rican wrestler Invader Number One with this distinguished award of Wrestler of the Month for the month of October. In recognition for the great accomplishments of this fantastic athlete, congratulations, Invader Number One, from the Board of Directors of the WWC, Martin Levy, President of the WWC, 11-17-86. And congratulations for being the Wrestler of the Month for October.
Bueno, la entrega oficial, la placa dice más o menos, el Consejo Mundial de Lucha, la Junta de Directores del Consejo Mundial le otorgan esta placa merecida méritos al Invader 1 por ser declarado luchador del mes de octubre a nombre de todos los miembros directores del Consejo Mundial de Lucha. Está la fecha abajo y el nombre del presidente Marvin Levy. Tus palabras, Invader 1.
Thank you very much for coming to Puerto Rico, all the way to Puerto Rico from the United States to give me this. I really appreciate. Quiero darle las gracias al caballero aquí por venir a nuestra isla y darme esta placa. Me siento muy orgulloso porque en realidad esta placa no es para mí. Esta placa son para nosotros, los fanáticos, para ustedes los fanáticos, que yo siempre, donde quiera que voy, pongo el nombre de Puerto Rico en alto y seguiré haciendo todo lo posible por hacerlo siempre.
Felicitaciones. And thank you very much, Mr. Pedicino, for being here, and we hope this is not the last visit.
It won't be. I love Puerto Rico, and we will be back.
A well-deserved award, Joe.
That's true. You know, the Invader Number One, what should have been one of the greatest nights of his life, unfortunately later in the night turned into a disaster. Next week here on Pro Wrestling This Week, we'll show you just what happened to the Invader Number One.